So I'm Becky of thepinksamurai.com, and today I have a semi-enamel pins 101 video for you slash just rambling video for you. I did a poll on my Instagram stories about what video I should make for today, and I was like, okay, do you want to hear about cute stuff or do you want to hear about enamel pins? And then most people always want to hear about enamel pins. So then I was like, okay, do you want to hear about Instagram topics or do you want to hear about how I got started? And how I got started won, and I was not expecting that at all. So I'm feeling a little bit self-indulgent right now. So I'm just going to kind of tell you my business story and ramble a little bit about that. So this is probably going to be a little bit long. So I'm going to go ahead and ask you to like and subscribe now, because pretty sure no one's going to get to the end of this video. Okay, so another thing I asked on my Instagram poll was if you wanted to hear just about pin journey, enamel pins, or you wanted me to go all the way back to like 2006 when I opened my Etsy shop for the first time. And you guys wanted to hear everything, so this is your fault. All right, you voted for this. So I am going to go into basically the whole story about how I ended up here with this kind of YouTube channel. And well, I'm not really going to talk that much about YouTube, but mostly just about how my shop ended up where it is now. And I hope you can learn from my experiences a little bit. It was a very different time in 2006. So I guess the internet was a very different place then, so I guess I'm just going to get into it. Ooh. I have a lot of notes here, so hopefully, I mean, this is going to be a long video, but it's fine. We're in it. We're in this together, okay? In 2006, I opened my Etsy store, and I was selling hand-sewn bags. So I designed original fun designs. I'll put some pictures here somewhere. And it was really fun. I would pick up fun fabrics. I did purses. I did like reversible purses. I did zipper bags. I did tote bags. I sewed them all myself, and it was awesome. I have been crafting forever. Both my grandmothers taught me how to sew. My mom taught me cross stitch and embroidery, and we were just very much a DIY kind of family. So we were always making stuff for the house and to wear and for anything. We were very much a project centered kind of family. So I was always doing stuff like that and making things for myself. And, you know, I also come from a family of entrepreneurs, so it was just kind of like, well, yeah, I mean, I make this, I can sell it, like, let's see what happens. And Etsy was around then. It was still very early. I think they started in 2005, so it was pretty early days. And I bought a lot of stuff on Etsy anyway. I thought people were really great, and I just was really inspired, you know, by people like Twinkie Chan and APAC Studios, if you remember them. I'll put links to people I talk about. I do talk to Twinkie Chan though, because she's really awesome. But yeah, so I was very inspired by a lot of these people, and the maker movement was huge then. Jennifer Perkins too, the Austin Craft Mafia was a big deal, and I was a huge fangirl of that, being from Texas. And I subscribed to Craft Magazine when that was around, and I still have them somewhere. And yeah, I was just really inspired by this group of makers that was really coming up. And so I was like, yeah, I'm gonna make some stuff and I'm gonna sell it and it's gonna be great. So started out with bags and zipper bags and stuff like that. Hi. So I am Next Day Becky. I am currently editing this video with Turks, and I realized I left a couple things out, so you're gonna see me pop in every now and then. First thing is how I got the name of my shop, The Pink Samurai, which is something that a lot of people ask me, and it's really kind of a dumb story because it was just my friends and I were bowling one day, and I was in high school. I think I was 18 at the time, 17 or 18, And my friend was making up ridiculous superhero names. So someone was like the blue microwave or the blue toaster, and he said I was Pink Samurai because I love pink and Japanese stuff. And so it just kind of stuck. And I used it for my AIM name for a long time, so it's been with me for a while. So that's where the Pink Samurai came from. Okay, back to regular stuff. So with my bags and zipper bags, I was definitely not charging what I should have. I was not giving myself a proper hourly wage, which is something people still struggle with. And I yell at people like, charge more money, charge what you're worth. You know, your time and effort and expertise is worth something. And I had to learn that the hard way. I was not charging nearly enough. And it got to be very labor intensive. I was going to school at the same time. I was getting an associate's degree in business. It was like general education and with a concentration in business. So I was taking a lot of entrepreneurial courses and accounting stuff. Business calculus is a thing, apparently, that our teacher even told us that we didn't need to own a business, but took it anyway. So I was doing that, and I was working full time, and I was making this stuff. So the bags were getting a little bit labor intensive, and I wanted to supplement it with something else. Also, yes, wearing leggings with my fancy shirt, working from home life. And so, anyway, so I started cross stitching and doing some embroidery stuff, and those went by a little bit quicker. And I could sell them for a little bit more, and that worked out really well for a while. I was super, I'm checking my notes. I was super influenced by just gamer culture in general. I was also on this site called OneUp.com. Hey, RIP, OneUp.com. It was a big deal for me at the time. And I met a lot of really great friends there that I'm still friends with now. So holla at my online friends. But I was on there, and it was just my life was games. I was working at and managing a video game store at the time, so a lot of my cross stitch and stuff was Mario sprites and like just gamer speak and stuff like that. And it was really fun. I really enjoyed it, and it was fun. I really liked branching out into more original stuff, but you know, people bought the sprites and the video game stuff more, which I think is kind of still a thing today. So I'm doing these cross stitches and having a lot of fun with it, but I wanted to branch out again. I don't remember what was kind of the impetus for the change, but oh, a kitten. But I decided to start doing perler bead stuff. Maybe I'd seen some of it on Etsy. I don't know. But I started doing just little perler bead figures from video game sprites, and then I started making coasters. So I would take perler beads and I put them in my own little like box, you know, and do like little Mario sprites and Mega Man stuff, and stick some adhesive cork onto the back, and you have coasters. And those sold really well for a while. It was kind of ridiculous. Like, those did really well, and I was really excited about it. And then I got a cease and desist from Nintendo. So, no more of that. I think Nintendo was cracking down a lot on people on Etsy at that point, and kind of soured my attitude towards fan art. And I mean, fan art, I was straight up copying their sprite, so of course they're gonna send me a cease and desist. So lesson learned there. So at this point, I got my CND from Nintendo, no more coasters. I was kind of wary about doing any video game related stuff, and I was trying to figure out what to do next. And I was working full time. I was a teller at a bank for a while, and I think that's about the same time. And my mom and I decided to get a button machine. We'd seen some people doing custom stuff on Etsy, and we were like, okay, well, if we can, you know, we want to make some buttons, but why would we pay extra to have someone do it for us if we could just buy the machine? So we had, I had a big collection of old comic books, like, and I would go to get old cheap comic, nothing good. I promise I was not cutting up anything crazy, but I would cut up comic books for buttons, character faces. Mostly my favorite thing was the word bubbles that would fit in and have silly things to say. And those did really well. My mom would cut up lots of vintage magazines and sell them. And we did that for a long time. And then I ended up getting Photoshop to start making my own designs, which was a big deal for me. So it was mostly text-based stuff, silly words, phrases, quotes, stuff like that. And those were pretty steady. I did that through, I was working at the bank, and then I went back to school and decided to get a BFA in graphic design. I had been seeing all these people on Etsy who were so inspiring to me, and I really wanted to draw. I really wanted to make stuff. I really wanted to do my own original things, because I had been kind of recycling stuff and doing fan art, such as it was, and I was tired of that, and I wanted to express myself. So I thought, I will go to graphic design school, and I will learn how to use Photoshop and Illustrator, and I can make prints then, and then I can, you know, do all this stuff and have an original body of work, and it'll be great. So that was the plan. So I went to design school, and I thought, you know, if I know how to use Photoshop and Illustrator, then I can do what I want to do. And learning the tools was so secondary to the education that I got there, you know, just the history of design and just principles of graphic design and all of these things, color theory, and they're all things that are so important, and I really cherish that time and the friends that I made and the artists that I got to meet. It was really great. And you don't need design school to learn how to use Photoshop and Illustrator. YouTube exists now, so you can do that. But I'm really glad for my experience there. It was so much more than I thought it would be, you know? And the technical stuff, you think, oh, if I get this brush, you know, if I use the same brush that this person has, or if I use the same color palette that this person, you know, does, then my stuff will be good now too. And that's never the case, you know? Like, you've got to find your own voice. And I think that's what I was really starting to do during that time at school, was figure out what I wanted and what I wanted to make, and really honing in on kind of my personal brand. I had a class called Agency, which was really great, and it was about working in an agency, basically. And that's kind of where I really decided I wanted to work for myself and kind of have my own business instead of working for someone else. And I think later on I realized while I was freelancing, I didn't even like freelancing because people's ideas weren't as good as mine. It's not true. I just liked my ideas better. And then I end up designing stuff that I didn't want to and stuff that I didn't even want to put in my portfolio. And so it was really good for to have that experience in school and realize, you know, kind of decide who I am and what I want to do. So that's really what I got most out of it, I think. Okay, so I graduated in 2009, since I did kind of AA, took some time off, went back to school. My timeline is a little wonky for most people's, and that's completely fine because everyone is on a very different path. and so between 2006 and 2009, I have my graphic design degree. I also got the Excellence in Graphic Design Award for my graduating class, so that was pretty exciting. and so at that point, I ended up getting a job at a startup in DC. So I went to school on the Eastern Shore of Maryland. Originally from Texas, moved to Maryland when I was 16 with my family, stayed there and went to college and all that, and then got a job in DC. So just so you kind of know the time frame. and so I'm working at this startup and I meet this cool guy, and everything is really great for a while. Personal life is a little wonky. I can get into that later if you want to know. But I met this guy and he turned into my best friend, and I loved being at work. Like, work was the best. So I didn't have any side hustle at the time. I didn't have a business that I was working on because I was really fulfilled in that job. And that is also another perfectly wonderful place to be. I had healthcare. I had a place that I could afford. There's nothing wrong with when you have a creative outlet in a 9-to-5 job. So that's just another path. Again, everyone is on a different path. So I was really into that for a while, and I loved it. And as I kind of progressed in that job, I got more into, like, I started as a junior designer, so I was working on design stuff, and it was really fun. And I learned a lot in that experience too, from my art director, who turned into my husband later on. And it was just really great. But as the company was getting bigger and everything was moving faster, and I was put into kind of higher positions and then managerial stuff, and that was awesome, and I was really glad for that. And I was not the world's best boss, but I tried my hardest, and I loved my employees, and they're all doing amazing things now. So if you're watching, I love you guys. You guys are the best. But it was not creatively fulfilling for me anymore at that point. So as things, you know, seemingly go well at work, I'm just not having fun anymore, you know? So I start up the side hustle again. And I was making a few buttons, but of course, as someone who has been in a bajillion different, done a bajillion different things, you know, started out sewing and did cross stitch and purl repeats and buttons, crochet was what I decided to do next. I had started crocheting. I taught myself on YouTube. It was just a really fun therapeutic thing for me to do after work, because my work at that point was really, really stressful. And, it was just this really nice mindless thing that I could do at the end of the night. So we'd put on some Next Generation, we'd put on some X-Files, and I would crochet some scarves. Plus I was in DC and it was flipping cold. So I made giant, ridiculous scarves that I loved. And so I was like, well, let me try and sell them, because that's just what I always did, was I made something and then wanted to sell it. So I started selling scarves, as you do, naturally. So the scarves were great because I got a lot of help from my amazing friends at work. I was actually kind of in charge of the photo team at this startup, so I had amazing photographers that would help me out with my product photos. And I ended up getting picked up on, like, Refinery 29, and the shop was doing really well, and I was doing drop shipping with this other really big kind of indie marketplace. And I got into Crafty Bastards in DC, which was huge for me. I was like, are you kidding? Like, I was over the moon to get into that show. It was the coolest thing. Checking my time. Still running long. It's fine. And so Crafty Bastards was really great, and it was the best experience I'd had so far at a craft show. And I think it helped that it was flipping cold that day and I was selling scarves. So, but also at that point I was charging more. So I learned from my past mistakes with one-off stuff, and I was charging what I felt was right. And, it was really nice. Still don't think I was charging quite as much as I should have, but it was a step forward. I was going in the right direction. And that did really well for a while. I was really enjoying that. And, I don't know, it was a lot of fun. So I'm making scarves and stuff, and I had been in DC for about almost 4 years, I think, working in that area, and the job was just a worst at that point. I was not having fun at all. It was super, super stressful. I was encountering some pretty cool sexism, that I think it was oblivious sexism, you know? It wasn't outwardly misogynistic, you know? But it was just very much part of the culture that I saw. And so I had been itching to get back to Texas for a long time. I had this sweet new husband who was into it. And so he ended up getting a job in Austin. So we moved. And it was awesome because after we moved, I was privileged enough to be able to work from home and very intentionally go about my business. So by the way, I had a blog during all of this that I just didn't even mention. But yeah, I was blogging too. And so I went headfirst after we moved into my blog and my shop. And so for the blog, I was like a DIY blogger and anything else. So I did a lot of, I would run around town and shoot thrift stores and vintage stores that I would go to. And I did two DIYs a week for a year or two. It was a long time and it was a lot of work. And in doing that, I was able to get a lot more exposure for my blog and then kind of move a little bit of it to my shop. But what I learned was that people don't really care about crocheted scarves in Texas. It's just not a thing. It's just too hot and it makes sense. Like it's not the thing. So I stopped making scarves and was focusing more on the blog at that point. I was going to a lot of blogger conferences. I did a Texas Style Council, which was amazing. I got to meet Elsie of A Beautiful Mess, which was like fangirl moment of the year for me at that point. And I did Blogcademy, so I got to hang out with Gala Darling and Cat Williams of Rock and Roll Bride and Nubby Twiglet, Shauna. So that was really great. And that I met a lot of amazing women through that, people that I still talk to and follow. I was really into the networking aspect of things. I was more intentional with what I was doing. I knew the things that I wanted to do. I was more in tune with who I was at that point because I had been through so many different iterations of my shop and my professional life at that point. And so I was just trying to plug in and meet folks and really be a part of kind of the blogosphere in general, but also my local kind of Austin area. And I was able to get in with the Austin Craft Riot. I don't think it's still around anymore, but I ended up meeting some of my best friends from Austin Craft Riot. And I'm very grateful to the people who put that on. And they were just a group of makers in Austin. So they would get together and kind of have seminars and talks about different topics, and I was kind of in charge of that for a little while, which was fun. And so I was able to meet a lot of people through that, trying to organize speakers and putting presentations together to teach people. And I really love teaching people. That's something I just really enjoy. That's why I like making the Enamel Pins 101 videos for you guys. And I just really enjoyed teaching and showing people and teaching people from my own experiences so you don't make the same mistakes I did. But that was, Austin Craft Riot was really great for me. I was able to kind of really navigate the craft world in Austin and get a better idea of what it was really like because I thought, oh man, I'm gonna move to Austin. I'm gonna be able to get my stuff in shops and you know, it's gonna smell like crazy. But Austin is a pretty saturated town for handmade, which is something I didn't even think would be an issue. So, a little bit of a reality check, but it was nice to be able to navigate a lot of that with people who were into helping. And really because of that, I think I was able to get into the Renegades in Austin, did a couple of those. I did Blue Genie, which was a really big deal. And that really helped bolster my business at that point. Because I was back on doing buttons and kind of accessories at that point after I dropped the crochet. I miss crochet. It's fun, but I just kind of do it for myself now. But yeah, it was really good kind of plugging in and meeting people and being really intentional with what I wanted to do with the business at that point. Hi, me again. This I think would be a good time to tell you that I started doing daily drawing projects, which was a really fun way for me to start building up my body of work again, because it had been so long since I'd really done anything super illustrative and creative. So I decided in 2013, I drew my outfit every single day of the year, which was really fun. And then in 2014, I did Ridiculous Holidays, as told by cats, like this guy. And so that was really fun. And that's actually where a lot of my button and pin ideas came from. It's really fun to have just a little prompt to work with. And then in 2015, I did celebrity birthdays as cats. So my crowning achievement there was all 9 of the Fellowship from Lord of the Rings. So I was really excited to get all the actors who played in Lord of the Rings. And that was really exciting and it was super fun and I'm really glad I did it. I was really able to like hone my style and figure out what I like to draw, and I would highly recommend that. I can share the hashtag for the celebrity drawings one, because I finally got my stuff together and had a hashtag on Instagram for that one. The other ones I just tagged randomly because, I mean, who knew what they were doing on Instagram in 2013. So yeah, I feel like you probably should know about that because it's something I did every day for 3 years and I just completely forgot it in the regular stuff. So yeah, okay, back to things. So I think because of that kind of intentionality, I was able to kind of go down rabbit holes and really explore things in a way that I couldn't have. And I'm very glad that I had that time to experiment. And I'm forever grateful to my husband for not thinking I was just sitting at home watching Netflix all day, you know? It was a lot of work. But one of the fun things that I did experiment with was a subscription box for the first time. So I had a thing called DIY, and I included a DIY project, which was like what my blog was all about, plus a fun surprise, what I called it. So it was just a cute little something from a cute maker that I knew of on Etsy. So it was really great. I was able to kind of merge these two things that I really liked and do a lot of the graphic design for it. I designed all the inserts and instructions, and it was a lot of fun. I had a handful of subscribers, which was like bonkers to me. And it was a lot of fun to do. I just really enjoyed it. And one of the makers I used was Sharon of Sharodactyl Art. She was awesome. And like, I felt good that I was able to support like independent cute businesses specifically, plus do a lot of the DIY, and people would share it online, and it was like, it was so cool. It was like this culmination of a lot of things that were happening. And I was a few months into that when my biggest DIY of all came about, my son. So I was pregnant with my son, and because the subscription boxes were very labor intensive. Again, I always kind of jump in head first with everything, apparently. So I ended up front loading a lot of that while I was pregnant. So I was getting like months and months set up, at least through the end of the year, and packaging up boxes and all that stuff. So I had everything kind of packaged up ahead of time, and I really had to just cut it out, because after my son was born, it was just way too much. I had to take maternity leave, and I was really glad that I was able to take about 3 to 4 months off of doing anything. So I was really just, Instagram was all my baby. And he was a really cute baby. But yeah, so I decided to stop doing the DIY, which was fine because I am forever about pivoting and changing and figuring out what's best for me creatively and monetarily. And while that would have been good monetarily, it was just too much. It just wasn't something that I could handle as one person and a tiny baby. So at that point, I had, I wanted to get back into the pins, and because that was really, you know, what was doing well for me before maternity leave. So I wanted to, I set a date. My son was born in October, and by the first of the year, I was like, okay, I need to do something. And so I set March 1st as my kind of shop reopening date. And I actually talked to my friend Jessica of Tiny Deer Studio. I'd met her in the kind of craft circuit, and she's amazing, just an awesome human. And she had been doing enamel pins. So I emailed her because I'd seen Susie of Boy Girl Party, and her pins are amazing, still amazing, Susie. But I was like, okay, let me just email Jessica and see what this is all about. Cause I thought it was cool. And I thought maybe my artwork would work well with that. And it would be a fun other thing. Just kind of add to the shop, you know? And, I'm clearly all about experimenting. So I emailed Jessica and I was like, hey, what's the deal with pens? Like, how much do they cost? What's going on? So she was my very first middlewoman and kind of showed me the ropes a little bit. And I got her a design and we made up my alien pin. And the rest is kind of history. Vegan! I think it would be good to note that I'm not going to go into super detail about like all the teeny little steps I did in my pin business in this video, because this is more of an overarching how the heck did I get here video. I will be sharing those details later. A lot in an e-course that I'm working on, which I forever talk about, but also on YouTube because I want people to know, because there are lots of things that I did that were really helpful and lots of things that I did that did not help me at all. So I will be sharing all the little minute details with you soon. Okay. So I saved up and I ordered my alien pins, and I did a little pre-order form. It was very rudimentary. It was, you know, just PayPal me and I'll send it to you, you know. And I was doing most of my stuff on Instagram at that point. And I had about 2,000 followers, I think, because of the blog. And that seemed huge to me at the time. And I mean, it is huge. I was able to jumpstart my business with that. So, you know, don't feel bad if you're like plugging along and you think it's not enough, because it is. And so I did a little bit of a pre-sale, and then on March 1st, 2016, 10 years after I started my shop, I offered my first enamel pin. And it was awesome. It did really well. It sold out eventually. You know, it wasn't overnight. I think it took a couple months. And I was able to use that money and funnel it into reorders and then funnel that into more pins. And at that point, I was like, okay, this is really working. Like, this is working better than anything else I had done. And so I was like, okay, if I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do it. So all of this planning and experience and everything I'd learned from all of the things I'd done before really benefited me at this point, because I was like, okay, I have a plan. I was like, Instagram is where I am. This is what I'm going to do. I had been all over the place on social media all during this time. Twitter was the first place, and that worked really well for Etsy in 2006, but not so much in 2016 for what I needed. And so I was like, I'm going to focus all my attention on Instagram and these dang pins, and let's do this. So I took a couple of Instagram courses, and they were really geared towards like lifestyle bloggers and stuff like that, people sharing their personal lives on Instagram. And that's not really what I wanted to do anymore. And I just wanted it to be about my products. So I just kind of dove in head first, and I was posting consistently. I was posting fun stuff, and I really hit that hard. And I started my email list, and it just, you know, 2016 was just the year of starting, and it was really great. And 2017 was the year of discipline for me, and I just banged at it. Like, it was my job, and it just kept going gangbusters, and it was awesome, and it was a lot of hard work, and it was very fulfilling and really exciting. Okay, one more thing. 2017 was also the year of the Pink Samurai and Friends, which was really exciting. Cat hair everywhere. Which was really exciting because it was just another iteration of my subscription box, like DIY. I decided to work with different pin makers, and it's something that I really love. We collaborate on a pin once a month, and it was just so exciting all year to work with amazing artists. And it's still going on now in 2018 when I'm making this video, and I give 5% of my profits to a charity of the artist's choice. So just another way that my journey kind of folds in on itself, and I end up doing learning from experiences and growing from it and new iterations and all that stuff. So I really love the Pink Samurai and Friends, and I'm really happy that it's doing well. And there's still cat hair everywhere, but I guess that's my life anyway. So okay, yeah, I just wanted to be sure I mentioned the Pink Samurai and Friends, and I'll have links to all the stuff down below. So okay, now back to the video. I promise it's almost done. And really exciting, and seeing people with my pins, like sharing photos of them and just seeing people's faces and hearing what they thought of them, it's just so cool, and it's still so cool, and I just can't get over it. So now that's kind of, I think that leads us to now. I'm still kind of figuring things out. It was very much about the business last year, and I do think I want to kind of bring it back and be a little bit more personal now, and I don't know. It's still a work in progress, so who knows what I'm going to end up doing next. But pins are my jam, and I'm really excited that I was able to have this opportunity to make them at all, and to talk to you guys and meet you at shows and meet you on the internet, because internet friends are real friends, like Adam JK says. But yeah, I don't know. I hope this has been helpful. I do feel a little weird just talking about myself for like Lord knows how long this video is at this point. I had to get up in the middle because my camera just stopped. The camera's like, cut it out. You're done. It's enough. But yeah, I think that brings me to now. I'm always experimenting, always trying to go out on a limb and see what I like to do, what you guys like to see, and all that. So I hope this was helpful. Let me know if you have any questions at all, and we'll be back to some more normal, less rambly videos soon. Yeah, so if you made it this far, thanks. If you did make it this far, if you could leave me like a wacky emoji in the comments so I know that you saw the whole thing, that would be awesome and hilarious. Pick something totally weird that like you never use. Like I want to see it. but yeah, again, any questions, let me know, like, subscribe, all that stuff. And I will see you on YouTube and Instagram later. Bye. Thank you for watching.